the world's greatest mysteries, interdimensional spacecraft, and intergalactic entities. Telepathy, tinfoil hats, and the shadow people who are standing behind you right now. Technology cover-ups and mysterious homicides. It's time for CSI New York with Gary Sinise. Huh? Oh, my mistake. It's actually time for Anomalous Realities on Revolution Radio.
You see things.
Yeah.
I don't know where I am.
In the space that's outside my physical reality.
Experiences, unusual experiences. I call them movements.
Yeah. It's crazy.
Would start moving. Zip from one place to the other.
And he showed me a number of things. He showed me some episodes from a few of my previous lives.
Yes, the creature.
Joining us tonight on Anomalous Realities is special guest, UFO hunter and researcher, Jeff Wills.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Anomalous Realities. As you have heard, our special guest tonight is a UFO hunter who has been searching for, I guess, life, perhaps, outside of our star system for a very long time. Everyone, please welcome Jeff Wills to the show.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey, all right.
Hey,
so
now, just to tell it, to tell you, it's Jeff Willis, like Bruce Willis, you know, but it's just spelled E-S instead of I-S. But there's another guy named Jerry Wills, so I don't want anybody to get me confused with him or anything. But my last name is pronounced Willis.
Like, you know, that's funny because I saw news clips and they pronounced your name.
they pronounce Willis, and then sometimes they get it wrong and they do the same thing, call me Wills. But Wills is like W I L L S, not E S.
All right. Okay. Sorry about that, Jeff.
Oh, that's
Willis.
No problem.
and our Mr. Robot did the same thing. Oh, speaking of which, have you guys seen Mr. Robot? Anyone? No? The show is absolutely amazing. It's kind of like a hacker's reboot, almost like Anonymous. I want to start out. I saw something with you on the Dan Aykroyd.
Yeah.
Yeah, on the Dan Aykroyd interview. Well, I guess it was like a documentary.
Yeah, that's a documentary we did with David Sirita and Dan Aykroyd back in 2005.
Now, whatever happened with all of his footage that he had for the Chicago O'Hare incident? Because it sounded like he got scared off.
Well, the thing of it is as far as I remember, is they never had an actual videotape or a picture of the actual O'Hare incident, but they did have plenty of eyewitnesses that saw exactly what was there. And so that's why they compared my video. There was another clip called Paranormal News where they compare my side saucer video with the news reportings of Chicago O'Hare of the same looking craft. So that's why they talk about Chicago on one of those clips of mine on YouTube.
Well, it had been long discussed in the conspiracy community that Aykroyd had actually acquired all of the videos from all the witnesses at Chicago O'Hare and was planning to put together, you know, a massive documentary all about it.
Yeah.
But that he got spooked by government agents at the end of his driveway in black vehicles. Do you know? Have you heard
that? Yeah, I don't know anything about it, and I don't know any of the footage, but I remember they showed my side saucer video, of my daylight video on that documentary, on that Dan Aykroyd documentary, but I never remember ever seeing any O'Hare footage.
No.
And I wish that the witnesses wouldn't wait for the documentary to come out if there is any video. I wish that they would just put it up on,
The rumor was is that he had bought it all.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the rumor was. I don't know if it was true, but it was going around for a long time right after the incident.
Right.
But now, so how did you how did you get started? Because you've been doing UFO research for a very, very long time. So how did this start for you? What ignited that interest in you?
Well, it really started when I was about 5 or 6 years old. I had like a personal encounter experience. When I was going to bed at night, one time something grabbed my hand in bed, like another hand. It felt like grab it, and so that's really what launched me into knowing that there was something else out there besides just like regular people. Like, so I was kind of opened up at a young age, and then I saw a few UFOs after that between the time I was like 6 and by the time I was 10, I'd seen like three UFOs sightings, and I was trying to relate it, if it was the same, connected to the same thing that I had experienced.
Right.
So later on in my life, I had a few more experiences, and I just kind of just kept researching UFOs.
The more experiences you had, it just kind of reinforced that interest, right?
Right, exactly. And so later on in like the early 90s, I saw on that television program Sightings. I don't know if you remember that show.
I do. Gosh, that's been so long. But yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, well, they had a lot of they had this guy on there that could film a UFO any time of the day. So I decided to do the exact same thing that guy did. And I started getting the same videos and that guy got. So I just started releasing them on, you know, the news and different media for people to see what I'm able to shoot. And I was able to, at that point, you know, start making, you know, a lot of videos. And I was able to compile enough footage in 5 years to release my first DVD, UFOs or Phoenix Volume 1.
Wow.
And that's the first one. And you can get that in Volume 3. That we have a special 3-pack set on my site at UFOsOverPhoenix.com. You can get the DVD and for three for the price of one, basically, because we had
can't
to
beat that.
Yeah, because what happened was is no one was a lot. I mean, the sales went down on people buying footage, online on people's a lot of people's stores. They don't get as much. You know, many sales as he used to, and you would think they would, because this isn't really like a entertainment video. This is like stock file footage of anomalous objects flying through the sky. So it's basically a case. You're basically buying like a casebook file on UFO, on ufology, on video footage. Like if you're an investigator, you're buying this stuff to look at it as a researcher, really. So, you know, normally we had, you know, three each individual DVDs, because that's how much footage we got over, you know, the years. We were able to make volume 1, 2, and 3. So now you can just get it for the price of one now.
That's awesome.
So we just put it all in there. And instead of doing UFOs Over Phoenix Volume 4 over the years, we just made newer DVDs with a different concept. And that concept is Other Sky Watchers, where I compile their footage in with my footage, and we make a DVD where it's all of, like, all of us. So the last four have been Alien Finders, Signs in the Heavens, and the new one is Contact from Zeta Reticuli, and there's a couple other ones in there we got too. But we just keep video. You know, I have a lot of friends that they share all their videos with me, so I'm able to collect them, you know.
Now, did you have the Jerusalem footage in any of those?
A while back, I had some of them, but, you know, it's hard. All of a sudden, when that one came out, all of a sudden, all these other ones started coming up.
I know.
I was trying to find out which one is the real one, because people were saying, oh, this one's the fake one. So I could never really figure out which one was the real one and which one's the fake one.
Well, I think there were several real ones. I think what the case was with that was that there was actually multiple witnesses at the same simultaneously from different angles. Because if you notice, some of the videos are from different angles, so they were actually separate people taking separate videos. So I guess several of them were actual legit. There may have been some that were, you know, mixed up at some point. But yeah, I think a lot of them were. You know, I think part of the problem is that, you know, there's so much on YouTube right now.
Yeah.
I mean, everything is just massively uploaded to YouTube. And of course, you've got, it's just full of all kinds of hoax videos as well. And it's so hard for the public to sift through and to try to find the right ones. I think it discourages them.
Well, yeah, and that's why on my site, I have another site. It's a UFOfootage.net. Mm-hmm. And what I do there is I put all of the footage that I think's legitimate, you know, and most of it is from YouTube or people or Skywatchers that I know that have a YouTube channel, or I'm able to, upload all of the footage that I have, onto another server, and that way they can just download it and it pops up on a real player. But I did upload some videos recently of some older things that I think that are legitimate, because that's what I like about older footage is it's less of a chance that it's been faked, you know?
Yeah, that's amazing, because it's really, really important for people to be able to have a source, you know, where they can go to that is already kind of sifted through it and helps them, you know, look at the videos that they can feel a little bit more strongly that there's a greater possibility that they're not tampered with, right? That they're not fake.
Right.
Yeah, because it's just flooded with it, you know, and I think that's the whole reason that it's done, honestly. I think some of it is like a disinfo type of thing.
Yeah.
I mean, don't you think that the government probably has, you know, some people actually creating these fake videos for the purpose of, making the real ones less believable?
Yeah, it could be. You know, I mean, we don't know really, you know, with this day and age and all, you know, you have a whole generation now that's grown up with like computers, like right in their face since they were a baby, you know. So we have like a lot of these CGI hoaxes and a lot of these other ones that, you know, that are put up there anonymously and stuff like that. It's a good chance that like 90% of them could even just be from like 12-year-old kids that know what to do, you know, and they know how to trick people. And then they're giggling about how many hits they can get off of their video, you know, and they're putting ads, attach some AdSense banners to it. And, you know, within a few weeks, they might get a check from Google for a couple $100.
Right?
So, you know, they're trying. Yeah. They don't even really care about, you know, the legitimacy of it or anything. Mm-hmm. You know, they're not even into the phenomenon, you know.
I think that's something that's always really bothered me, because I don't think that people that do the hoaxes, those that aren't, you know, initiated by outside sources, I don't think they stop and think about, you know, what they're doing and how it will affect the community and the research efforts of others as a whole and the way the public views it, you know. I don't think they take time to think about that, and it's honestly really bothered me many, many times.
Well, there was a show on a while back called The World's Greatest Hoaxes on Fox, and I think that they made two shows on it over the years, and there was one part in there where they showed just a couple college kids about how they've made a video of a ghost walking through an alleyway at the school, and then they changed it, you know, the background, and yeah, and it looked real. It looked like a real ghost video.
Wow.
So, it's pretty easy stuff.
You know, that's one of those things that I've said a lot lately, is that it's really unfortunate that we do live in a day and age of such amazing technology, because, you know, anytime you try to have proof or evidence of something substantial, it's almost impossible to, you know, be able to say that couldn't be recreated by CGI, because there's so much that can be done by CGI.
Well, if you're able to get the original video, like the phone that it was shot on, or the original camera and the original tape, they can put it in a computer and find out if it's fake or not. You know, they can find out. But you know, so that would be the best real UFO video would be any that were even shot from some of these camera phones, because some of them shoot really good video and they're able to zoom in real good.
Mine doesn't.
So like if it made like major news across the nation, like a really good sighting on your phone, they can just take the whole phone and do an analysis on it and say, yeah, this is real. This is not a hoax or whatever.
Yeah, that's good point. I actually got, I was taking pictures of the moon, I think it was a week and a half or 2 weeks ago, And in looking back, in one of the sequences, there's something under the moon that wasn't in any of the others. And I don't know if it was a bug. I don't know what it could have been. But there was definitely something going under the moon in one shot that wasn't in any of the other shots. And it had to be rather quick. And I might have to post that up on the website, which is anomalousrealities.com. That's the site for the show. It's our homepage. And that's really just got the links to, you know, our social medias and everything like that on it. But it's in development. You know, I'm doing the website myself, and I'm not much of a webmaster. so it's a work in progress. I don't have all the time in the world to put all the content on it that I want to, but I want to get a lot more on there than what we have currently. So I'm working towards that slowly but surely. So I want to know a little bit more about the sightings you had when you were young. Can you tell us a little bit about those sightings, what they were like?
Sure. When I was about, I think I was about 6 years old, I saw 3 UFOs in formation.
Oh, wow.
And they were like, they looked like V-shaped, like smaller craft.
Right.
And so I asked my I asked my parents, you know, what are inside UFOs? And they were like, well, we don't know. Like, you know, it was a weird question for them. They couldn't answer. And my mom said, maybe on a computer or a robot. And they didn't say there was no such thing or anything, but they couldn't answer the question of what was inside of one, because right. I told them I saw one. And so they were kind of wondering what was up with that. And then later on, when I was about 10, I saw a daylight one again, and this one looked like a water tower type, but underneath it was like, it looked like one of those backyard swimming pools, like flipped upside down. So it was like a perfect circle, a dark circle with like a weird cone, brown. It was like brownish in color, dark, but it was like wobbling back and forth right over the neighborhood houses, real close to the ground.
Huh.
And it was very close. I mean, I could have, you know, if I would have taken a picture, it would have been like one of the best pictures out there at the time.
Yeah.
But I was only like, you know, 10 years old, you know, right. or something like that. So like later on after that, I had some experiences too in my house, in the house we lived at in Seattle, Washington, where I grew up, is we had I had a few odd experiences in that house.
What happened?
Well, one time I woke up. Now, I haven't really shared the story too much, but too many times, but yeah. I have shared it before, so I can do it again. But
okay.
This is what made me feel like maybe I was being taken or contacted by beings or something like that from these craft.
Yeah.
It is one time I woke up at like in the middle of the night, like 2 a.m. or 3 a.m. It was really early. And I had like a weird taste in my mouth. And so I went in the bathroom and I like spit out like this black, like looked like chewing tobacco,
a
big old wad of some black, like a dirt
fluid
or something,
or
like
something?
Soil. Oh, it looked like, it looked like that, like Copenhagen or some chewing tobacco, like a whole a can full of like spinning, and it was dirt or something. I don't know what it was, but it was like syrupy too.
And
I thought to
gross?
Myself, yeah, it was horrible. Huh. And I thought to myself, like the first thought in my mind was, I need to save some of this because this is like a phenomenon. This is some sort of, you know, this is not normal.
Right.
Like, you know, what is this stuff? I mean, it wasn't nothing from my body or anything like that that I could have like swallowed or anything. This was like something that was not right, you know. And so like I brushed my teeth or whatever, and I still had that taste, you know, for like a whole couple days in my mouth. Like, but like, it was horrible, you know, and I couldn't ever figure out what it was, you know.
What I find interesting is that you had the presence of mind to actually think about saving some. Because I found that among people who have had multiple experiences, there's a heightened awareness, you know, with people who have multiple experiences. And it's usually, I mean, it's not just UFO experiences. It can be paranormal as well. So that raises up another question. Have you had paranormal experiences as well?
Yeah, I have had a couple experiences where I don't know if it was like a being or an entity that was in the room. And I also had a sighting of some type of creature or a robot type of thing before. I've been also had that paralysis before, where I can't move, but I can move my eyes, and I can see things happening.
Sleep paralysis.
Yeah, but I'm able to open my eyes, able to see what's going on, so I'm able to catch like a glimpse of what's actually going on and who's got under the, you know, why I'm paralyzed and what's going on.
What did you see?
Well, a few times. The first time that I experienced anything like that, I believe it was around 1992 or something like that, right in there. And that was when I was paralyzed in my bed. And this was what I first thought was an abduction of some kind, a failed attempt, but more of an astral abduction, not a physical abduction, but an astral one, where I was paralyzed and I felt like something grab inside of my body and start to pull out my soul or whatever, my astral body, out of my body to try to force me to have an out-of-body experience.
Right.
And I got halfway, like it was floating me out of my body partial of the way and part of the way towards the door. And that's when I yelled in my brain. I yelled, "No, you can't take me." And the next thing I knew, I was back in my body and wide awake.
Yeah.
And this was the same room where another incident happened that same year, where I woke up in the morning and I was wide awake, just lying in bed. And I heard a voice come out from the side of the room. It said, "Get up," like a really scary, like demonic, weird voice. And I was like, "What in the heck is that?" And I thought it was like my stepdad playing a trick on me.
Right.
And when I looked to the window, I noticed it was completely closed.
Mm-hmm.
And because the sound came from that direction. So after I, you know, thought, well, maybe it was him, you know, cracking the window open a little bit and doing that from outside. After I saw it was locked and it was closed, then I was like, wow, that was like audible and you can really hear it. And so I'm trying to connect it, the paranormal thing, with the alien thing and the UFO thing, because over the years of the study, it all comes together. It's all actually interconnected somehow.
It has to be. I remember years ago, I used to frequent Graham Hancock's website, and you know, there were all different, he had, you know, lots of different research forums that people would come together and share their stories. And I shared there once that I thought there has to be some sort of master key that connects all of these things together, because there is a shared experience phenomena of paranormal activity, UFO encounters, abductions. And I think that there are some cases in which paranormal activity is mistaken for something completely different than what it actually is.
Right. For the instance I was going to tell you with synchronicity, there's the UFO abduction phenomenon from a personal standpoint, from my opinion, from what I've experienced through it, is that synchronicity follows people that are in contact with them. And I don't know if synchronicity follows people that are in other aspects of the paranormal, like ghosts hunting or Bigfoot hunting or whatever. But with the alien abduction phenomenon, and I don't even think that half of them are actually abducting you. I think they can come right into your room and do whatever they need for like 10, 15 minutes. They don't even need to move you to a spaceship or anything like that, you know?
No.
And most of these encounters, they don't ever see a UFO or a spaceship. There's only a very small fraction of them that are even connected with a UFO. So it makes me wonder if some of those encounters are aliens to begin with. They could be completely different entities, like masquerading behind it. Synchronicity, I don't know, for instance, have you ever seen, looked at the clock, just glanced over at the clock and it said 555 or 333?
Yeah, all the time. 11:11, 1:11, 333. I'll tell you the one, one of the synchronicities comes, it has to have something to do with travel, because it always, 444 always comes up when I'm in my car, for some reason. Always comes up when I'm in my vehicle. And I'm not sure why, but that one always comes up, and I look over and it's 444.
Right. That's how it starts off. And then what happens is when it comes to a point where it gets completely ridiculous.
Mm.
It, for me, I was at one point where every time I looked at the clock. I glanced at it. It was 1-1-1-2-2-2-3-3. Like first, it started out in the morning. Like at like when I woke up, I looked at the clock. It said 9-11, and then it said 10-10, 11-11, 12-12, 1-1-1.
It just progresses. It just gets more and more and more. It started for me. It started with 3:33 in the morning, and it continued that way for a while during those first years, and then it got to be more, you know, more different times. But for a long time, it was just the 3:33. And then it got, over time, more and more and more until there was more synchronicities just constantly happening. And, right. you know, I think it's a progression of some sorts. I don't know exactly.
Well, what it does is it bleeds over into, like, certain categories is what it does. Mm-hmm. And what, like, for instance, like, what happened to me is, like, the number thing, the clock thing's off the chart for me. That happens, like, sometimes, you know, it'll be every single number, every like every hour, and then sometimes it'll just be a couple of them. But then it bleeds over to television and radio. And what I mean by that is, like, one, like when you're one, for this is one little paranormal story. I fit it into the paranormal because it's intertwined with this kind of weird stuff. But like I was about ready to back my car out of my my driveway, and I had the radio on. And there was a commercial that came on about a local plumbing company. I'm not going to name it or anything, but when I heard the commercial, I looked in the rear view mirror to back out, and I seen the truck for the same company, right pulling out in the cul-de-sac around, you know, the back end of the cul-de-sac. Before I was able to back out, I saw the same company that they said on the radio at the exact same second.
Wow.
And then, yeah, and then it gets even better. And so I went down the block to the gas station, and right when I was pulling into the gas pump, into pump number 4, the guy on the radio on the commercial said 4. Said number, yeah. And so then at that point, I was like thinking, well, this day I better, you know, buy a lottery ticket, or this is just one of those days where it's just going to be every, like, all day long.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like hard to even leave the house sometimes when you're like, this stuff is happening all day long, or you're at work, or, you know.
Yeah.
You're like, how can you think about it? You know.
Well, these synchronicities, I personally feel, are messages, almost like nudges to get your attention from your guides, the ancestors, ancestral spirits that are around you, and other guides that you have with you. It's like they're trying to make sure that you're aware of certain things. And so they're letting you know that they're there by these synchronicities. And right. I think each of these number synchronicities have different meanings. I'm not 100% sure of all of those meanings yet, but
they
I'm
do.
Working
and
my
I-
way.
And I was going to say, I had a diary where I wrote a bunch of them down, because it's happened so much or so often. I started to keep a notepad of it, because it's not normal for, like, other people. Like, I try to tell this kind of stuff to, like, normal people that don't do any of the kind of stuff that we do.
Yeah.
And they have no clue. They're clueless. And, like, and it bleeds over to television, radio, like what I was saying before is with the TV. Before, I've seen, like, Tom Brokaw or different people on the radio or on television say someone's name. Like, what this was a weird one. There was a guy on the radio that said the name Jason Bales, and he was just talking about some guy named Jason Bales, you know. And so my friend is named Jason Bales. I have a friend that's named that. And so as soon as the announcer said that on the radio, my phone rang, and it was Jason Bales right on the phone. So it does that with television, too, as well. I had an announcer say some guy's name, Tom something, and then I had my friend Tom call me right at that point, too, at that moment. So I don't know really what's going on there, but it's some connection. Like,
yeah, there's definitely connection. I go off in a tangent. We're on UFOs tonight, but there are some things I think that we are able to give messages to ourselves as well, from our higher self, the part of us that is still connected. Because I personally understand that there is, in our bodies, is part of our spirit, our consciousness. But there is part of us that's still in that space that is outside of time, outside of physical matter, that is connected to everything. And I think we are able to give messages to ourselves in these ways, to let ourselves know things. I think that's the source of where the sixth sense comes from, is that bit of us that's still touching that outer veil. And so I think some of us are a little bit more open to that part of ourselves, and so we get messages more frequently.
Right. Well, when I was really young, I had some weird experiences where I felt like I was flying and also like coming down from the ceiling, waking up like I was coming down from the ceiling, like spinning in, before I hit the bed. So I couldn't tell when I was younger whether they were dreams or whether they were real. But I remember at one point, like flying over the city and being, you know, starting to go really, really slow. And I thought, well, if I go any slower, I'm going to fall. And that's when I like felt like I came back in through the ceiling and like woke up in my bed, and
feeling that, right?
And I felt the dizziness of my brain, like the spinning of being dizzy. I don't know. It was very weird, and I was like wondering if it was real or
if you were perhaps astral traveling, because I think there's a certain amount of sensation that comes with the astral self.
But it's got to be connected with the UFO, in my opinion, because it was all happening during that same time frame. So
funny thing you mentioned that, because there was another guest of mine who was on the show. Her name is Sherry Wild, and she's a lifelong abductee. And that is one of the things that she would say, you know, is that one of the signs of, you know, abductees is that feeling like you fall into your bed, because it's actually like when you're being returned.
That was one of the other experiences that I was going to share with you from before, is I felt like something was a hand pushing down on my back one time when I was asleep.
Oh, wow.
And then, you know, I was at a normal sleep, and then I felt like the pressure of some hand on my back pushing me into the bed, and that's when I became paralyzed. That was one of those paralyzed
sleep
moments.
Sleep paralysis,
again.
Yeah.
Right, and this was when I actually seen the being, before.
You saw it.
Yeah, when I was able to fight the paralysis to the point where I was able to quickly break out of it, break free of it, I was able to roll over my back as quick as I could to see what it looked like, and it had the same drawings as you always see of those gray aliens, but the skin was more of a brownish color, and the tighter fitting near the jaw part where you can see like veins popping out of its cheekbones and neck, and I didn't see anything below the shoulders. It was like from the shoulders up.
Yeah.
And this was during the broad day. It was only like 12 noon out in the afternoon outside, so the light was coming in from the window because it wasn't dark out. So this thing was happening during the broad daylight. So these things aren't afraid to...
No.
You know, it doesn't matter whether it's night or day.
They don't care about time of day.
Exactly. They can... And if they're interdimensional or whatever... And that's the thing. I only saw it for one... Like, under a second. It wasn't even a full second before it disappeared. So it was either interdimensional or it had some sort of technology where it can, you know, pop in and out of wherever it wants, you know.
Well, it's funny you mentioned the one that kind of looked like the gray but was more brown in skin, because I've talked about this on the show, but I actually had a face-off, so to speak, with one of those who was in one of my son's room. It was just a couple of years ago, actually. And I got an understanding after that, because I was out of body. I was astral traveling at the time. And I went into my children's room, and I saw this creature in there staring at them, and it looked like a gray, but it was brown. And I basically told it to get out.
Right.
And the thing is normally, with any of these type of entities, whether it be paranormal or extraterrestrial, there's not a lot that you can do, you know, to physically get rid of them. But when I was in my astral body, for some reason, I had a lot more, I guess, ability to interact and enforce my will upon them to leave. So that was something that I came out of that. I went back into my body and I woke up and I remembered everything. And I had an understanding that I could keep them at bay and keep them away from my kids if I protected them on the astral plane.
Hmm. Well, see, this brings up another point now. Is it that are they able to transcend both, or is it done with, on their part, is it done with technology, or is it done like with their own, you know, biological ways of how to do it? And this also, this raises a lot of questions about are they ETs to begin with, because of the fact that if we have an alien implant that can be pulled out of our body and it's some sort of piece of metal that we can put in and, you know, some sort of like science can look at it and say, hey, we don't know what this is, like they did on that show before with alien implants and what they've done with them before, where they have no evidence, they have no conclusion. And they're basically looking at this thing saying, yeah, this thing could have came from outer space because it doesn't match anything that we have. You know, that's happened before with alien implants. So if those things that are taken out of their body, it's physical and it's put in there by someone that's physical, then those people could be the space aliens. And are they transcending this reality that you're talking about? Or are those beings completely different than these guys that can put something physical in your body?
I think that, I think there's multiple types of things that are interacting with us.
I think there is, because you can't just... You know, see, that's the thing. I really would like it to be the guys that can actually leave a physical implant in you. Because if it's these other guys, that could be demonic or just some sort of entity that you don't want to mess around with. That could have been here for thousands of years and that's just waiting to, like, wreak havoc, you know.
Because when you're dealing with entities of different dimensions, I see dimensions in, you know, in, I guess, relation to frequencies and their vibrational rate, and lower vibrational beings that exist on a lower plane generally tend to be a little bit more negative in their nature, whereas the ones that are of a higher vibration seem to be, you know, more positive, more benevolent in type. We're here for tonight for you, but I've had some experiences with both types and I like the higher vibrational ones more.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure you're familiar with the stigmata before, where people have actually gotten their arm, their wrists start bleeding.
Mm-hmm.
Have you seen that before?
I've not seen of it, but I've heard of it.
Have you heard of it? I mean, okay. Well, like people that are, you know, have some sort of religious experience with, like, you know, they have the wounds of where the religious figure had the same wounds.
Right.
And they start bleeding. Well, that is not just, you know, just with religion. This is something that can transcend through the paranormal. And it's happened to me in my experiences, and I don't know if it was alien or an entity of some type. And I swear it's the oddest thing. I was reading a book about UFO abductions, and in the actual chapter where it talks about bruises and scratches and scrapes on your body, during the time I read that at night, that chapter, I put the book down and went to sleep. The next morning, my son had two black eyes.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And it was like trying to send a message to me that is what I'm reading is going to be a confirmation. And they did something to him, and he didn't know what even happened. He woke up in the morning and came out of his room, and I was like, what happened to your eyes? And it looked like like black circles, like when you can't, when you haven't slept in a few, like really good in a few days.
Yeah.
That's what it looked like under
dark
both of his eyes.
Circles under his eyes.
Yeah, but it was all on the top too, on the top parts too. Yeah, and it was they were pretty dark, and it was like during when I thought to myself right immediately what I just read the night before, and I thought, are they trying to tell me that they're gonna send me a message through messing with my kid, you know? And it made me kind of freak out.
I can imagine.
And I thought it was, you know, to the point where it's like, I don't care if these things are alien or what. Yeah. If I'm gonna put like a cross in my combo over my kid's bed or something, you know, if they're demonic, then they can get out of my house and stay away, like you said, you know.
Right.
Once they start messing with your kids, you're like, you know, I don't care what you are, get the heck out and never come back.
Well, at the point I actually had them, they've messed with my kids. I started teaching my kids to do personal shielding techniques to try to get rid of them, to try to keep them away. I taught them some things to say to send them away, because quite frequently, if you just tell them to go, you can get them to go. Some people will, you know, call on a religious figure, you know, to send them away. With my kids, I told them, you know, to just tell them that they were not welcome, that they sent them away with love, but that they were not welcome and that they had to leave. And there were some other techniques I taught them too. I taught them meditation at that point because it was important to help them learn how to shield themselves.
See, that's what I always told myself, if it's alien or not alien.
Yeah.
And because in my opinion, if it's a real alien entity and an alien being, no matter who you pray to or no matter what you say, you're going to be taken by the alien, because it's the same thing. If you're in line to get some money out of the bank and a robber comes in and he's going to rob the bank, and he points a gun at you and he's going to shoot you, you can say anything.
Say whatever you want.
You're still going to get shot. So the deal is, if it's an alien, unless God or whoever you're calling out to really wants to do something, then that alien's probably going to abduct you, and he'll probably just bring you back later and you'll be all right. But, you know, the ones that take off, the entities that take off running and screaming as soon as you say something, you know, they don't like, then those could be the really bad ones.
What I've also found is that smudging seems to work for extraterrestrials as well as spiritual phenomena, which is very strange. I didn't expect it to work. But it's almost like a repellent for some reason. I'm not sure if they just don't like the scent of burning herbs, or if it is the intention that is done when you smudge. Have you ever smudged before?
I burned the incense before.
That's similar. Similar.
Like the smell of them, and I've done, you know, you can pick them up anywhere. So just to make this house smell good. So I don't know if it helps, but
it will help. What you could do is put it into something like a bowl or something that you can actually take around and get the smoke into like every single like corner and crevice of your home. And as you're doing so, put the intent of love and protection into it with your thoughts as you're waving the smoke into every area. And that will help protect it much, much better, because otherwise you're just getting a small area. So you want to get your whole house covered.
Well, with this house, we've only lived here about a year and a half, and nothing's happened so far.
Oh, wonderful. But, it takes time sometimes for them to find you.
But I have shot a lot of video in the backyard of UFOs. And that, like I was, you know, telling you before, I have a YouTube channel with a lot of the videos I shot of footage from the crafts, you know, then I put in those videos that we sell, and the DVDs that we sell, and, you know, they're like UFOs, you know, they're unidentified flying objects, you know, and we shoot thousands of hours of videos, so we try to, you know, pull all the ones out of there that we think could be a balloon or a bag or whatever, so we just try to keep with the best stuff, you know, so generally, that's what I was saying before, is the footage of a sighting of a UFO I shoot, you know, and then that, you know, nothing happens the next day or the next night. It's not followed up by any type of visitation usually. Usually
Which
the visitation.
It's different than.
Yeah, but I have had them intertwined before one time with footage too. This was in around 2001. I was paralyzed in my bed, and I felt something grab my left leg, I believe it was my left or right leg, I can't really remember, but it pulled, it was like something grabbed like hold of my ankle with both hands while you're laying on your stomach on bed, and pulled really hard and kind of dragged you along the bed while you're paralyzed, and I thought it was my roommate playing a joke on me while I was asleep. And at the time, and so I woke up and there was nothing there. So I opened the door and looked on knocked on the next room, and I saw him in there sleeping. This was back, you know, when I was when I had an apartment. And so I went out to the window and looked out the window, and I saw a black object hovering over the apartment complex, right over my apartment. Yeah. So I grabbed my video camera. And I pressed record and started getting it on video. And this was, I think, 2001 footage, like January 17th right. or something. It's on the on my new YouTube channel.
Awesome. I'll have to check that one out for sure.
Yeah, and so, you know, they sometime intertwine like that. So I don't know if they're all connected with the UFOs, but some of them
But some definitely are. Now, you've got that video up on your channel. Do you have on your channel anything describing that, you know, leading up to that so that, you know, if I were to look for it, would I know that that's, you know, the craft that is a related to that event?
No, because I have a lot of the same type of craft, the same similar types.
Okay.
And during that time frame, I was shooting a lot of black objects. And by the way, my YouTube channel is UFOs Over Phoenix, all one word, UFOs Over Phoenix. And my two sites, too, are UFOsOverPhoenix.com and UFOsOverPhoenix.net. And then we have that other one just for UFO footage, which is UFOfootage.net. So I pretty much have three sites and then the YouTube channel.
Okay.
So it's a lot of space to put all sorts of good stuff up there.
Yeah. Speaking of your YouTube channel, now you had, there were some videos, it wasn't YouTube, it was some other video site that is very, very well known. And I'm trying to, if it's like Meta Video or something like that, but you had some UFO videos up and it was, oh my goodness, it was the early 2000s. And this is how I first heard of you. Because you had, I was looking for other UFO sightings of a gold sphere. And yours was the only one that came even remotely close to anything like what I had actually had as a personal UFO sighting in 1997, which I want to get into 1997 a lot more after we get back from our break, because we're getting ready to go to the break in about 5-6 minutes. I don't want to get started on that yet, because 1997 was a very powerful year for unusual phenomena.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So I think I'm going to save that one for after our break. Real quick, I see if Mark or Melina might want to ask a question before we go to break.
Sure.
Guys?
Well, yeah, hello, Jeff. Very hello. Interesting stuff. I guess I'm going to go right back to the very beginning. Did you meet Dan Aykroyd? Is this, did I get this right?
What happened was, is they had a meeting with Dan Aykroyd, like a party, like a DVD, release party. Mm. And this was before they called me to have my footage put in the DVD. Right. What it was basically done at that point was just all the interviews of just Dan Aykroyd talking were shot at that point. And so the only thing left to do at that point was to get all the footage and then put it in there with his interview to make it like a smooth, nice documentary. And so they did a DVD get-together release on it. And they there were some other people that met him, like David Sirita and a couple other people with video on the DVD. So a couple other Skywatchers, but unfortunately I wasn't able to meet him. And so I got a call a couple of weeks after this meeting, and they asked me if I would like some of my videos to be put onto the DVD. And I was like, sure. Yeah, definitely. I want to be part of the DVD.
Brilliant. Brilliant. And so you've seen that and you're happy with that.
Yeah, there's a few different versions of it, actually. The first version was the Graviton Productions version of it, and we were able to sell the DVD on our website. And after a while, like a year or two, they sold the rights to a big film company, and so they remastered it with more video footage of different like anomalies, like space stuff videoed from different like satellites and stuff like that. They added some more footage to it. So it became kind of different, but a, you know, better documentary, really, in the long run.
That's cool. Well, I know it's trivial to most, and probably yourself, but then do you feel then you have had your sightings or videos at least endorsed by Dan Aykroyd?
Definitely. That was one of the. That was one of the highlights of my UFO video photography career.
No doubt. Was
because I got this case. You know, when the video came out, I got a box of DVDs because I was able to sell them on my website, so I was able to mail them out. And I saw this awesome cover with Dan Aykroyd, Unplugged on UFOs. It was a black case, a black cover with his picture on it. And when I flipped it over, it said starring David Sirita, Dan Aykroyd, Jeff Willis, Pat Uskert, and then Mark Olson, Billy Meyer, and to have my it was a very short list. It was only like six or seven names, and to have my name on a list on a back of a DVD with Dan Aykroyd's at the top, and then mine's down the line, you know, in a short list of seven people, was like amazing to me, because I saw his movie Ghostbusters when I was only like probably like 15 years old, you know, so it was a big thing, you know.
That's cool. That's cool. Well, that's good. None of my videos have been endorsed by Dan Aykroyd, I'm afraid, but good
going. It's funny because then you find out, oh, this guy's interested in this stuff too, Dan Aykroyd. I didn't think I always thought he was, you know, into it somehow, because he always made weird movies about paranormal or odd stuff like that.
He's one of the more vocal people, definitely, but I can name many other A-listers, I don't think.
And that DVD actually led to some better things, actually, if you can believe that. And it wasn't – I wouldn't necessarily say better things, but stuff at the same level of that. A matter of fact, I got a call from Walt Disney Pictures. Huh. And they said, yeah, we got this Dan Aykroyd DVD we're looking at, and we like all of your footage in here, and we're actually going to have a new movie coming out with The Rock, the wrestler, and it's going to be called Race to Witch Mountain. It's a remake of the 1970s films of Witch Mountain, and they said, we want to have your footage on it, and I was like, oh, that's awesome. And so it was great, because I got a paycheck from Walt Disney Pictures for 7 seconds of video, which boils down to 5 clips on Race to Witch Mountain in 2009.
Disney, well, they love their UFOs, but that's cool.
And it was cool. It was just a kid's movie, but if you watch it, it's kind of cool.
Because your footage is there in the...
Yeah, and that's what they did about at the opening segment of the movie. They have like 100 clips shot by a bunch of different people, and they mix mine all in there with them.
So would you say this is all related to the synchronicity stuff you were talking about earlier?
It is. It's weird because if you look at my bio, you'll see I'm on all these different TV shows and all these different radio shows. And it's like, how can one guy that videotapes UFOs have so many appearances and be on so many shows? And not even have my own TV show, you know. So it's kind of funny because the way it works is probably that it's synchronicity. It's like all the gears are working and getting me where I need to go, you know.
Yeah. Well, I've got more questions, unless Melina.
Sure.
Melina. I don't have any questions. Okay. My next question then is, did you say you can summon UFOs?
Well, that's a funny thing. I wouldn't really call it summoning, even if you could, because the fact that we've done experiments before. And what happens is we've gone out there, and me and other Skywatchers have done this, where we try to make a UFO show up. And when we do it, we've had things show up. But at the same time, when we don't do it, we've had things show up. So we've had things show up when we do it and when we don't do it. And we did this on purpose. We said, like, okay, this time we're not going to do it. And it showed up anyways. And I don't know why that is. But this another thing is my friend did an experiment where he tried to summons the UFO. And instead of a UFO showing up, a balloon showed up.
Right.
And so we don't want to say that he's consummating, you know, a balloon or a plastic bag or sky garbage. We don't want to go that far to that extreme, because that's probably just a coincidence. But we could, you know, there are these people that they put footage up there of them summoning a UFO, and when they zoom into the video, it's actually a balloon and it's got a string on it. And they actually post that as an anomaly, because they call it like a balloon anomaly or an advanced anomaly study or an advanced variable or whatever. And these are the type of guys that in the UFO community that me and a lot of people that are doing sky watching for years, we come after those guys and we kind of debunk them, and we like kind of, you know, we go after them a little, because, you know, in our opinion, it's just not, it's probably 99.9% possibility it's probably just a balloon. If, you know, if it looks like a balloon, you know, or a duck or whatever the saying is, you know, probably is.
Looks like a duck, quacks like a duck.
But they go to the far extreme that they're mimics, that they mimic. The UFOs are mimicking a bag that says a grocery store bag called, that says fries on it, or a balloon with a string on it. They go to the extreme where you can't call them out on it because they just they're like, oh, it's a mimic. So
they take kinda, it too
they wash far. Their hands on it, you know, like we believe in mimics. So if you don't believe it, then get lost, basically, is their opinion. So we have to try to weed these people out and say this part is not belong in the UFO movement or UFO community or video or Skywatch video or anything. This is a whole different thing that of like crazy people, in my opinion. So I mean, I'm sorry if people believe in balloon mimics and balloon and that kind of thing that are listening, but it's just too extreme for me. I've had too many real saucer encounters and real encounters to believe in that other stuff. So.
All right, and that is our cue to go to station break. We will be back after these messages.
Government conspiracies, paranormal activities. Can I get fries with that, please? It's Anomalous Realities on Revolution Radio.
Welcome back, everyone. We are speaking tonight with Jeff Willis, who is a longtime UFO hunter and apparently also a paranormal experiencer. Before we get back into the show, I just want to do a real quick mention for the station. If you enjoy listening to the shows, if you enjoy the guests that we're bringing to you, if you enjoy all of the viewpoints that are brought forward on this show and all of the shows here on Revolution Radio, please just take a minute, visit the homepage, and click on the donation button. Give whatever you can. Could be little, could be a lot. Doesn't matter. Every little bit helps the station because we are 100% user-supported. If you would like, there's also seed packs that you can get, which is a nice way that you can actually purchase something and donate to the radio at the same time. And these are really nice organic seeds that you can use to supplement your own garden while you still can before the government decides that we can't grow our own vegetables anymore. And with that said, welcome back, Jeff.
Hey,
and
how
Marky.
You doing?
And Melina, are you back with us too?
Hello.
Hi. Now, did you have any questions, Melina? Because we were kind of...
Well, no, I'm pretty much on the same page, you know. I also believe that the interdimensional and the extraterrestrial, it's the lines kind of blurred mm-hmm. as to what are we actually dealing with. You know, because the components to a lot of experiences that people have tend to be more paranormal and more interdimensional in nature than nuts and bolts.
Yeah, and what I'm able to do is I'm able to look at everything and say I think we're looking at two different things because, or a few different things, not two, you know, more than, you know, quite a few actually, but I'm not afraid to look at one of the things that's going on, and that's absolutely that we're being contacted by some type of different beings that actually originate from a different planet
mm-hmm.
or a different physical location. Because yeah. like with the Barney and Betty Hill thing
yeah,
and the star map that we later found out that these guys were coming from Zeta Reticuli, that's kind of thrown a whole monkey wrench into mm-hmm. Of, you know, now maybe we have an idea of where they're coming from, you know.
As well as the Hopi Indians.
Mm-hmm.
As the Hopi Indians, you know, have brothers and sisters who visited them. And many other tribes have as well. But they were actually given, you know, direct star locations of the Pleiades where their guardians, I guess, came from who protected them. And according to the legends, they were protected through each of the great Earth cataclysms. So that's very curious because it indicates that it's not a recent thing, the visitation. It's something that's been ongoing over a long period of time and I think is the Ancient Aliens series would suggest is that, you know, it is entirely possible that they haven't just been watching over us, but that we were possibly genetically engineered by them, which is a theory. Gosh, you know, I think it's hard for some people to accept, but it's one that we maybe cannot dismiss.
Well, they seem to treat us like that because, mm-hmm. you know, like how we
children,
how we put chips on animals that we tranquilize yeah. and put them back in the wild. They treat us the same way as that.
Yeah.
So they pretty much act like they're a higher species. They, you know.
But they're sometimes very protective, too. And they seem to keep an eye on us. I think that's
right.
Part of what the abduction thing is, you know, they're, it's like
yeah, it's not
checking
a one-way
on
street.
Us physically. No, it's not. We've done some experiments on them as well. That's another thing. I think we were talking about that last week, weren't we, Marky? The aggression of our species towards anything outside of our own planet. We were talking about that... that island where pretty much nobody has ever been able to actually contact these natives because they attack anyone that comes to their island. And I said that's kind of like, you know, a parallel to planet Earth, because anyone that tries to approach our planet from an outside civilization gets attacked. Like the Battle of L.A. in 1942, the craft just sat there. And it didn't do anything, but we started firing on it. And it didn't fire back, but, you know, they kept firing on it.
Right.
Yeah.
They thought it was the Japanese.
Yeah.
They had to go in the middle of the war because, apparently, and it was kind of a weird timing for a UFO to show up right in the middle of a war.
Right?
But, you know, not good timing.
No. Well, I think wars have always been one of the times when UFOs kind of peak, isn't it? I mean, they definitely seem to be curious when we fight.
They are, and you know, they always say the modern era of ufology started after the atomic bomb, the two that were dropped. And, you know, after that, the Kenneth Arnold saw the 9 discs over Washington State, and shortly after we had a crash in Roswell and people talking about crashes in Kingman, Arizona, and also down here in Phoenix, there was one too. And then, you know, the list goes on and on and on.
Yeah.
But, you know, of course, the secret weapons that have come out of Area 51 may be responsible for some type of shoot down of some of these objects.
Mm-hmm. What is your thoughts on Area 51? Do you think that it is still the secret base that it once was, or do you think they've moved everything?
No, I think it's pretty. I think it's exactly the same as when you know the height of it. You know, because you know if you've got to look at it, we're never going to know what's in there anyway. So then why would they really move it? You know, everything's done underground. You know, all their experiments.
Yeah.
You know,
it's just when you have people constantly, you know, trying to get in there, trying to see in, you would almost wonder if they wouldn't try to move everything to another location where people don't know about it.
Well, the whistleblowers that have come out of there have talked, have leaked some of the stuff that's been going on, you know, in there. Like, for instance, there was the plasma beam weapon that, you know, that they assumed was to bring down extraterrestrial craft.
Right.
There was also the other project, Looking Glass, where they were able to view things that happened in the past. And so there's some things, you know, when tax dollars, trillions of dollars of tax dollars go to black budget research for years and years and years, of course, they're going to have time machines and stuff we don't know about.
Now, have you ever witnessed, any type of biological UFOs or some that seemed organic in nature?
Yeah. A matter of fact, but it was one of my experiences where it wasn't a UFO. It was some sort of thing in an entity of some sort. I thought it was a robot of some sort, but it was shaped like this was an experience where I was paralyzed again, but I was able to see through my eyes what I was viewing, and I could see the television on, and I could see the game that was on TV, and then I saw next to the TV this object that was hovering above the ground. And it was shaped like a U, like a brown, it looked like a brown U-shaped object, and it actually looked like a lady's purse because it had these little fringes hanging off of it. Like it looked like little leather fringes, like a little leather purse with fringes, but the fringes started flipping all over the place like an octopus or some sort of weird, like, organic entity.
Tendrils
like
or something.
Yeah, exactly. And the first instant was in my brain was, is what in the heck is that? And I couldn't move. And the weird thing is why I think it was some sort of alien robot that maybe they beamed in there, is because it hovered right over where my DVDs were, where all my Skywatcher footage was on it. And it looked like it was downloading all of the CDs for a split second. And then I was able to break out of it. Like right after it took off, it let me go. And I was able to move around. And that was the first time I ever saw like some sort of robot or entity other than a humanoid before. So I don't know. It's one of the chalked up weird experiences.
Oh yeah, I'm sure you've had many, many, many.
But it did look organic though. The beam looked organic. It didn't look like a. It looked like an organic robot because it didn't look like it was
right.
Like human or anything.
So strange.
Or like a,
it's hard when you experience something like that to put it into words so that people can understand, you know, perceive what you saw, what you experienced.
Right. I mean, that's the weird thing about it, is it was only about the size of a basketball. And that's why, you know, I was saying it looked like a woman's purse, the shape of it, you know, but it was brown again, this color brown, and these weird tentacles that were flipping around. And then it moved over to the left, and it like hovered over where all my Skywatcher footage was for a few minutes, and then it took off. And like as soon as it left and I got up, I thought the first thing that came to my mind was that was some sort of like thing that was sent in there to download my footage or something.
Well, you know, that leads into another question. Have you ever had another experience where you felt like they were exchanging information with you, like your experiences were being downloaded to them and perhaps they were giving back to you at all?
Yeah, but not, you know, not so direct. You know, it's like something that you've like later on, you figure out this, like something pops in your head. Mm-hmm. And it's like after these synchronicity events, it's like a slow stream of them. And then, boom, a new idea of something.
Like an understanding that you can't explain. You don't know how or why you understand it, but you just do.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yep, that's what I thought.
Okay. It happens all the time.
Uh-huh, yeah.
And I come up with all these new ideas for my site and what to do with the footage and stuff that I... And then I forget it for a while, and then I think of it again. Mm-hmm. It pops up, and I thought, oh yeah, that's right. Why didn't I finish doing that?
Yeah. Well, the thing is they often they will mess with your memory too. They will make you forget certain things. That's why, you know, in some of the cases of abductions or, you know, direct contact like that, they may not remember seeing the UFO. I had an instance with my youngest daughter who. She actually remembers having an organ replaced because it was apparently it was going bad and it would have killed her if it hadn't been replaced. But the signs weren't there to know that she needed to go to the doctor. So they took care of it. And she thought it was a really weird dream when she, you know, was put back and woke up from it. But she was hurting really bad in the area where, you know, they replaced it. And when she was, quote unquote, in the dream, she asked them why they make people forget. Why do they do that? And, you know, they said, well, it's, you know, for your safety and, you know, to help you not, you know, have problems with it or not have traumatic memories and stuff. And she said, don't do that anymore. I don't want you to make me forget. So she was allowed to remember that. And the thing was, is she thought it was a dream for the longest time until her sister told her that she had been freaking out when she... before she had come in telling her about that dream. She said, what are you talking about? She said, you were trying to get me to go out there and look at that UFO that whole time, and you were outside. And she woke up outside on the pavement. And she, her memory was completely twisted around. She didn't remember talking to her sister about the UFO that she had seen. And this was a triangle-shaped UFO, which I hadn't even realized until she told me about that, that we had actually ever had a triangle UFO sighting. We've had lots of UFO sightings in the family, but the triangle UFO is one that we had never had to memory. And so when she told me about that, and when her sister said that, it was very, very unusual. But, you know, the thing is, and that's the thing that I was trying to get to, is that, you know, they, for our safety, they say, they try to make us forget. So some of these times when you, you know, feel like you're falling back into bed, but you don't remember anything. That's why I think Sherry Wilde had also said, you know, that's one of the things that are indicative of having been abducted, because there's very few things that you will have as evidence of it, because they don't let you remember a lot. Very rarely do they.
Yeah, there was a point where, you know, all of the, you know, cases, they always, you know, erase the memory, and then the people mm-hmm. relive it under hypnosis.
Yeah.
You know, it comes back later. Like I had a dream where they always took me to this location and I would remember it every time, mm-hmm. but I can't ever, I don't remember where it actually was in real life, you know, but they always take me to this place, you know, and every mm-hmm. time I would think it was a dream, it was the same place. And I thought, oh, I've been here before. This is that place that they take you. Mm-hmm. And I always wonder, you know, wish I could find out where that place really was, because it was like outside somewhere.
Right.
You know, and the thing with the, you know, it reminds me of that Barney and Betty Hill thing again, because at first Barney was having trouble sleeping and he couldn't go to work anymore and he was having nightmares and stuff. But when they took him to the hypnotherapist and he relived the incident of getting on board the UFO and the being telling him things and doing the examinations and stuff like that, after that came out and they put it on, you know, audio tape, and he relived it. You know, and they were able to regress him and then get him mm-hmm. out of the hypnosis and back to normal. After that day, he went back to work and everything went back normally to his life. So yeah. After he was able to get it out of his system, he was able to return to what he was, you know.
Yeah, sometimes your brain just keeps nudging at you until you get something like that out, because it wants you to remember. Have you ever had any regressions done?
No, not I didn't want to, because I tried to do a self-hypnosis one time and uh-huh. I started to see things that I didn't remember, you know, consciously. It was like I had opened up my subconscious mind to relive things that I couldn't remember. And mm-hmm. once I started to relive it, I turned it off and I was like, I'm not going to go through it. You know, it was kind of weird, because I had some missing time experiences when mm-hmm. I saw that low UFO. When I was on my bicycle, I chased after it through the woods, and I believe I had a missing time experience.
Yeah, I had a missing time experience last week, actually, and it kind of freaked me out. My daughter works not very far from where we live, and so I took her some dinner the other night. It was at 7 o'clock, and then I came back. It's like a 10-minute drive, and I grabbed my daughter because she wanted to go to a Pookie stop, which was just up the road, like a quarter of a mile. So we went, did that. When we came back, it was 9:30. And I'm talking, we were in a very short period of time and a very short distances that we traveled. And I don't know where that time went.
Yeah. It happens a lot with driving and, you know, in a lot of cases.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, that actually happened recently. I think that's one of the things you have to determine, is whether or not to do the hypnosis, have the regression done. Self-hypnosis might be a bad idea, just for the sake that, you know, it's hard to control it when you're doing it to yourself, because you don't have the abilities to, you know, take you back out safely. And you can't fully give into it either if you're conscious enough to be able to take yourself back out of it either. So you'd have to determine to let someone, you know, to trust them to do it for you. My suggestion would be to have a recorded session.
Yeah.
So that, you know, every moment of it, you know, you're aware of in the after. And then they could allow you to forget it again, but you have the option to consciously listen to it without actually fully remembering everything you experienced. So it's not quite as jarring that way as it would be to just allow you to remember everything. It might be something you think about, because you definitely seem, I, I, I say this, but I haven't done it yet either because I'm, as you are, somewhat a little hesitant to, some things are meant to be forgotten. I think there's a reason sometimes that we block things. And like they said, there's a reason that we forget. My daughter, you know, the pain when they removed one organ and replaced it with another, she said, was just excruciating. You know, I don't think they think about, you know, pain management at all. It's part of probably why when their people are taken and, you know, they're medically assessed and things, it's so traumatic is because it's extremely painful. Because for some reason, they don't seem to have empathy, perhaps, in that manner to consider, you know, the pain that the person is going through and to try to find a way to alleviate that for them in the way we would, you know, if we were doing a procedure on a fellow human being. So I think that's part of why they make people forget.
Yeah.
Perhaps. So I want to go to 1997 now. Okay. There were a lot of things that happened in 1997. Were you a firsthand witness? Well, now that was 2001 for the Phoenix Lights, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you saw them firsthand? Did you get video of them?
Yeah, 1997. I got some orb video on the Phoenix Lights, and I got a triangle thing, and it's actually on this newscast on my website. Yeah, on the videos, it's way down at the bottom, and there's two of them. One is like a daylight craft, and the other one is the other video is the Phoenix Lights stuff, and that's the two Fox ones down at the bottom. And they're actually, if you go to my site and then you click on Jeff's videos, it'll take you to a list of videos, and they're down at the bottom, and they're the two QuickTime videos. So you have to have QuickTime player to watch those two videos. But basically, it's a small triangle. It looked like a, you know, when you're far away, you know, underneath it, if you're right underneath it, people always said, oh, it was a huge triangle, you know, a couple, you know, football fields and massive. But if you're far away, like the way I shot it, it doesn't look so big, but it still was pretty big. It wasn't anything like military or conventional, that's for sure. I think it was definitely an alien encounter of some
type. Too large to be our military, I would think.
Right, and that was a 7 o'clock sighting through 9, basically, because there was other stuff that went on that night where a lot of people, there was a new movie that came out called The Phoenix Incident, and it was actually like a motion picture. And what they say is that the 10 o'clock sightings where you see the line of lights over the South Mountain area, that big old line of 8 lights, they say that that was a diversionary tactic. Those lights showed up at 10 o'clock at night, those 8 lights. So they think maybe the flares were dropped to divert any attention from earlier sightings of the triangle. So if anybody reported it, they would say, oh, those were just those military flares or whatever. So a ton of stuff went on all that night, though. There were reports all night long.
So it was an attempt to discredit previous reports that would come in to explain it away in a way that would seem natural, normal.
Right, and there was also other sightings of legitimate UFOs, like, all through the night, that very same night, but in different, like, outskirt areas of Arizona, like, you know, all over, not necessarily right in Phoenix, but all over the surrounding areas. And if you look at the reports that came in that night, we always like to use the Peter Davenport UFO Reporting Center because you can search by index, by state index, and then when you get to the Arizona, you can pick up the day and year. And if you go all the way back to the 1997, you know, the March 13th, 1997 day, you'll see all the hundreds of reports that came into the reporting center. So it wasn't just the 10 o'clock thing that happened that everybody sees. You know, every time they see every time someone says the Phoenix Lights, you see those 7 or 8 lights in a row. That was supposedly the flares at 10 o'clock that the military said that we dropped flares at 10 o'clock. That's what that is. And so all the other sightings that happened before that of the boomerang and the triangle, it muddies up the water on those sightings because this is piece of footage is nothing like what the other people saw and described, you know.
That's interesting. What was it like to be a part of that when that was happening? What did that feel like?
Well, you know, we just looked at the videos later, and we, you know, then everything hit, you know, the next day where people were saying, oh, we saw UFOs, and so maybe what we did get was a UFO, and, you know, we had it looked at, and so they put it on TV. And there was other people that taped stuff, you know, year after year, and not just that day, you know, like we, like what I taped, I keep taping them. It doesn't really matter if a million people see them on that one day or if I just see it by myself. I'm able to shoot footage like on in 2005, I was able to shoot a piece of footage that everybody calls the Phoenix Lights when they see it. And it's not, because it is the Phoenix Lights, but it's just not the famous 1997. But the footage that I shot of the Phoenix Lights is better than the footage that I shot of the original Phoenix Lights. So, you know, go figure. I mean, this is like, you know, how many years later, 2005 from 97, and I'm shooting footage that's even better than the original. But that never, you know, that piece of footage that I shot in 2005 is used on all of the TV shows. Like, it was on Factor Faked on the opening segment where you see, you hear my voice and I say, it's a series of lights, and it goes, you might remember the piece because I was on the episode one of the show. So they incorporated the opening track of the video of the opening of the show. And it was on a bunch of other, it was on the Race to Witch Mountain movie, and it was on the Dan Aykroyd DVD. It was on, you know, Sci-Fi Channel Factor Faked, and the that was Sci-Fi Factor Faked, and also X Testers on Discovery Channel. So it's been on a lot of different shows, that same piece of footage, but every time when they see it, oh, that's the Phoenix Lights, and it is, but it's not the 97. So it's amazing to get to people to think of that UFOs. You know, to see UFO, people always think, oh, it might be just like a one-in-a-lifetime experience. But the truth is to get you to think that, no, it's an experience you can have any day. Yeah. You know, it happens every day.
Yeah. You know, well, so you know, we discussed this once before on our show, but there are certain situations where it seems like there are craft that some people can see and others cannot. And this is a discussion I think Mark and I have had, that perhaps there are, and I think, I think David Marler was on, and we were talking about the idea that perhaps there are some that have the ability to control who they present themselves to. But I think some people are more open, and they're just paying attention more than others. Because some people say, you know, I've never seen a UFO. I always want to see a UFO, but I've never seen a UFO. We presented the idea that perhaps some people, going back to the vibrational level of different people and how some people have a higher vibration, some people have a lower vibration. If some of these craft are interdimensional from different levels of reality, it may be that some people don't vibrate at the same level as them and don't see them. But would that... would that explain how you can capture it on video? That's the only thing.
Well, I mean, it's able to be captured on video, or, you know, otherwise they would probably wouldn't, if they didn't want to be seen, they probably wouldn't let you see them.
Right.
But you always hear that, and where a UFO is tracked on radar, but they don't see anything.
They don't visibly see them.
And they also have the other way around, where they see it, but it's not tracked on radar, where they can't get a radar hit on it. So it just depends, I think, on the UFO, what it wants you to do, what it wants you to see. It's all up to them, you know.
Really. It really is, because, I mean, when you think about it, we currently have technology that allows us to cloak. Now, we are finally militarily at that point where we can cloak human beings, we can cloak objects. So it's ridiculous to think that a species that can either cross time or space or dimensions wouldn't have the ability to cloak themselves, which means when we see them, they want us to see them. They're allowing us to see them willingly. Right.
Yeah, and they talked about that at Area 51, that Robert Lazar guy that came out. He said that if a UFO doesn't want to be seen, all they have to do is energize into the upward position of a, you know, up, mm-hmm. you know, straight up and down, and he said and you couldn't see it. It would be invisible until it came the other way, so, or powered lower, you know. So you don't know what type of crafts can do what, and what they are, like these plasma crafts. I saw one of these the other night, and I wasn't able to get any video of it, but I saw this huge, like, explosion, like, right over the power lines, and I thought it was lightning, but then it blew up into like a huge oval orange shaped light, like craft shaped, and this was at night, so it was like right over the neighborhood, and then it just was like that for probably 10 seconds and then completely disappear. And I wasn't able to get video on it, but that was telling myself that if I would have got footage of that, that would have been one of the best videos I ever shot out of like hundreds of videos. So you have to wait for that one moment where you're able to get something too.
Yeah, I have to admit, when I'm in that moment, I just can't take the time to get a camera because I don't want to miss what I'm seeing. I don't want to turn away and have it gone, you know? If I don't already have something with me, I'm just like, you know what? I don't care if anybody else believes me. I'm in this moment right now. I'm bad about that. But going back to 1997, there was also the big sound, the bloop that came from the oceans that was heard from one coast to another, 2,000 miles apart. And this is in the same year as you have the Phoenix Lights. It makes you wonder if there's some sort of correlation there, because this was never explained, this gigantic sound that was, you know, recorded on radars, and, you know, makes you wonder.
Yeah, there was all sorts of stuff going on that year. You had the Hale-Bopp comet,
mm-hmm.
and everybody was looking at the skies, and there was chaos about, you know, there was some video pictures released of an object following Hale-Bopp, so people thought there was like a massive UFO following it.
Being hidden in the tail.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
And then 1997 was the year that we saw the gold sphere, which was, you know, what I was looking for more of when I came across your videos.
Now, was that a daylight sighting?
It was a nighttime sighting. We were at a drive-in theater, and this is kind of where we came in, because it didn't seem like everybody saw this, but we all saw it. I had my husband, myself, my oldest two children, who were probably about five maybe at the time, and then my youngest daughter was a baby, an infant, and then we had two of my cousins who were about my kids' age. And so there were there were seven of us in the van. And we were watching Jurassic Park, I think, the very first one. And it was towards the end of the film. And I see this light out of the corner of my eye. And I turn, and this giant gold sphere, it's probably about the size of a Volkswagen Bug is what I described it as. And it was hovering about a few feet above the ground. So it wasn't, you know, like touching the ground, but it wasn't way up high in the sky. It was literally, it went right next to us, within, you know, 10 to 15 feet of my side of our van, went right by us, like parallel to us, past us, and then it shot up into the sky at an angle and was just gone so fast. But we all turned almost at the same time. It's like we saw this glow and we all turned and saw it go by. And it was like a perfect fluid-looking metallic sphere that was just like a shimmering gold. It had illumination, but no lights. It was perfectly fluid. There was no seams, no lines. It didn't. There's nothing that made it look mechanical.
We've seen. I have video of something like that, similar.
That's how I found you.
A red object. Yeah, that one. And of course, there's the red ones that you know.
Oh, too, really?
Of course.
I haven't seen the red ones.
Yeah, there was a period of about a couple of years, but it was in particular this one summer of like the year 2000 where this red UFO would show up, and we got tons of footage on it. It would show up at like 8 o'clock, and it would come at the same time all the time. Like, so a bunch of different people got triangulation on it. I'll try to get some. I think
is that
you
on
know,
your videos or?
Yeah, it was. Also, the same type of object that was seen over Gulf Breeze, Florida, over years, called the one that they call Bubba. Yeah. Remember, they named it Bubba. Mm-hmm. It came so many times.
Yeah.
So basically, it was that same thing, but it looked like blood red when you seen it up in the sky. It looked like a drop of blood, and it was weird. It was like bizarre looking. Like, oh wow, that's like a weird color of a light. That's not a light. Oh my gosh, what is that? You know. And it looked like a planet or something just hovering up there, you know.
So. Actually, we saw a red. I couldn't tell shape. It seemed round. But we saw a couple of red lights in the sky when we were moving. And this was actually after I actually had one of the only experiences that I can remember of actual interaction with some beings that were not human. I don't know if they were extra dimensional or extraterrestrial. But we were moving to a new place, and as we had to do, because things always got really bad paranormal-wise. We were moving, and we saw these red lights in the sky, and they were just sitting in the same spots for the longest time. And my mother-in-law actually was the one that noticed them. She said, "What are those?" And she points them out, and then they switch spots with each other in the sky. One goes one way, one goes back the other way, and then they switch back again. And so we all just kind of passed it off as, okay, they're watching us.
Yeah, that sounds like the same video.
You kind of get used to it. Really?
Yeah, it's the one that was on all those shows that I was telling you about where they zip, like one skips across the other one.
Yeah.
But like one on the right disappears and then appears onto the left of the other one. Like it teleports to the other side of it. Or it skips through reality.
Yeah, they didn't do that. They actually, I've watched them move. I didn't see them teleport, but that's still, wow.
Yeah, we were calling it the ricochet because we didn't really know what to call it. We just seen it like move through time and then appear at a different location in the sky like so fast. It's like, you knew it was like whatever speed it was, you knew it had to have been like at least like Mach 100 and it didn't make any sonic boom or anything. Wow. And we don't have anything that can go Mach 100 and, you know. Nothing.
No. Well, they'll always try to contend that we don't know what our military power is, but there are certain laws of physics that just seem to not be breakable.
Well, I always see this in like some of these abduction stories, like the Betty Andreessen one, where they put her in this tube full of some sort of like solution, this like a type of liquid stuff, and they put her in there, and they said they needed to do it for safety because they were going to go at some like speeds, but the other the aliens weren't in any type of safety.
They didn't
thing
need
either.
It.
Yeah, they didn't need it because they're controlling the craft through their mind. Like they're part of the craft. You know, they somehow can be one with everything that they're with. You know, but we can't. Like, you know, we can if we were like astrally taken. Because there was a point where she was astrally abducted into the ship, and she was able to do whatever they did, and she didn't need the container when she was with them like that. So it's kind of a weird thing.
Because she had the physical body. And
exactly.
It's interesting. I don't think I'm aware of that one.
Yeah, that's in The Watchers, the book The Watchers by Raymond E. Fowler. And they also did something else, which was really weird. They did an astral abduction on her where the being pushed a button on his belt and she came out of her body. And and it was done electronically. Actually, it was a box he took off of his belt and placed on the table and pushed a button, and then she came out of her body and she was standing straight up with the being in her spirit body that this electronic thing, whatever it did, took her out of her body, and she was standing right in front of the alien, and she looked over at herself laying on the couch and was shocked to see herself lying on the couch, but then to see herself in an astral form looking at herself, at her hands and her legs, and the being said, "We have to go this way this time because there's too much activity outside," he said.
Wow.
So that's in the Watchers book.
I'm going to have to read
that's
one.
Like the third in the series of the Betty Andreessen case, and it goes like five books. But, you know, that shows that there's a technology behind some of this stuff.
Now, which race of alien was that had taken her?
Well, it looks like the small gray.
Really?
But there's so many different many different versions of them now. Mm-hmm. And that one had an like a shirt with a like a insignia on it, like of a phoenix type of third on it. So, like her first sighting was the Andreessen Affair 1, and then 2, and then the Watchers, and then the Watchers 2. And so
that's a funny word, the Watchers, because that's I'm writing a book about my life right now. I'm a shaman, and I've been working on this, and it's actually the name of one of my chapters, because Watchers is the name that I used to use to refer to the shadow beings that used to always watch me in my room when I was little. And so I had a whole chapter on that, but that also seems to apply to extraterrestrials also when you are in a situation where you are being abducted, taken frequently, and watched.
She never had any like bad experiences with them. Like there was never any negative experiences throughout all of the encounters and all the books. But at the same time, they were able to come get her anytime they wanted, and you know, and take her to these different worlds and scenarios, and there was nothing that she could do about it at the same time. So
it maybe got to the point where she just put that safe, you know, that safe spot in her psyche where she just didn't care. She allowed herself to not care so that she protected herself from being afraid or, you know, traumatized by that situation by simply allowing herself not to, you know, respond.
Yeah, and I was going to say there was another weird thing that I noticed that fits into the literature. It was like the first time I noticed this phenomenon, and it fits right in later because we discovered that it goes right dovetails with all this stuff later that you find out, like synchronicity and all these other things, is that she got, in the second book, she got divorced, and she met her second husband through a UFO conference type of a thing. And she found out that she had known him before at some point through this UFO stuff. And so she felt like in the story, the way she wrote it was that she felt like the aliens set her up with her future husband.
Wow. That's awesome.
Because he had a sighting too. And that's why he was there.
Yeah. Wow. That's awesome though. And that's very interesting. That worked out well for her then.
Yeah, and you have to wonder, like, they're behind the scenes in so many things, like synchronicity, so you know that they're behind the scenes there. That's their way of telling you that they're still, like, in your reality without you seeing, you know.
They're like guides.
Exactly.
Yeah, in their own right, they're like guides. That's interesting. Now, I want to give Mark the opportunity to ask some more questions. I know he's been quiet since the break. So, Mark, do you have anything extra you'd like to ask?
Thank you. Well, yes, I was going to ask Jeff, as a UFO hunter, have you ever had any luck with trace evidence?
Well, trace evidence is something that we always like to study, you know, in books and stuff like that. But you know, you always want to get it for yourself, of course. And well, the only thing that I've come close to was there was this place in the Superstition Mountains in Arizona over like East Phoenix area, where there's been a lot of sightings of like UFOs landed on the ground and actually entities on the ground.
Nice.
So we went to this area in this location, and we were able to locate like tracks of some type of footprint that didn't match any animals or anything like that, and we just videotaped them, and we held them to this compass, this electronic compass thing, and it went crazy when we put the compass near the footprints. The needle started going all over the place, which indicated that there was like some sort of magnetic disturbance on the footprint area. And and during that investigation, I saw a red orb pop up behind some of the bushes, like far, like about a couple hundred yards away. A red light came up from behind a bush and started to like take off. And this is during the twilight hours, like, you know, before it gets dark. So I was able to see it, and it just kind of dimmed out as it got further away, like took off probably at about 40, 50 miles an hour in the other direction. So I have no idea what we came across that night. But there was another investigation we had in an area that was similar to that, where we got on videotape a shadow being that, yeah, and it was weird because on the tape, it was in the background. We see two shadow beings pass behind us, and we had set the camera up, and we're videotaping ourselves, like kind of having an interview, kind of talking to each other about the investigation. And when we played the tape back, we saw the two shadow beings pass behind us, and we were out there doing an investigation on those beings that had been sighted in the area, like the landings and the aliens on the ground. And it was funny, when we played the tape back, she was telling me a story about how they had seen some they had seen a bean, but they couldn't get the camera on it to videotape it at the time, and they missed it. And she said, hurry up, get the camera on it. You're moving so slow. And right when she said that, the two shadow beans passed behind us. So as she's telling me a story about missing the beans, they're on the news telling the story with the new video. The beans are behind us, passing behind us. So there's that synchronicity again.
Wow.
So you have to wonder, you know, why would they show up right in the middle of the story of telling us about how they missed the sighting before because he was so slow, and then they show up right behind us during that same, during the story. And we don't know that time because they were behind us, but when we played the tape back, we were like, oh, wow, they were right there and we missed them. They knew where we were, but we were out there looking for them, but they were like, oh, let's play a joke on these guys and walk behind them while they're taping themselves. It was pretty funny.
That's good. Well, I did just have a look at your site, and I found that QuickTime movie of the ancient report from Phoenix. That's cool. At the end of that video, there's a guy, Jim, doing something on a computer screen with it. He's like enhancing it or making a mock-up of what it might be. Is that right, or is he debunking it?
He was comparing it to some other sightings that had similar shapes, but the other video is above it is the Phoenix Lights one. That was the Phoenix Daylight Dome video I shot of this saucer that had two domes and like three little balls of light underneath it. But it's the other Fox one that has the triangle video at night that I shot, but it starts out with these glowing orbs that I shoot, and then it shows a daylight sighting that I shoot, and then in the same clip then it shows the triangle thing, so that I shot on March 13th. So you just got to watch that clip too and see the triangle part, because they put it like somewhere in the middle of that story, because they showcase several different pieces that I've shot. And at that point it was like 1998, so it was only like a year later, so they were trying to feature as much stuff that I shot from before the Phoenix Lights, and then after the Phoenix Lights. When you see that, you'll be able to see the actual triangle that everybody else shot. There was only a few videos of it.
That one's real media. Real media, I haven't used that format for about 20 years.
Yeah, it's because the clips were so old that... you know, they have to just stay there forever now that they're there, you know.
would you say that was the sort of start of your videoing career when it comes to UFOs?
Yeah, because in 1997 was when I got my first website, because I had all this video and I was like, well, let's start putting this on my website. So I had a guy put a website on there for me. And at the time it was called umedia.com/Jeff Willis UFOs. And then because it was on his server, he made me his own page, my own page on his server. And then later, like a couple years later, I was like, well, I need my own page because this is getting too big and I have too many videos. So that's when I launched the UFOsoverPhoenix.com thing. And so that's been around since like the early 2000s. But it was like before I turned it to UFOsoverPhoenix.com, I had it as a GeoCities site, like a couple years before 2003. So in 2003, it became UFOsoverPhoenix.com. But basically, we had been around since 1997 before that.
I can't believe GeoCities. Oh, my goodness. That's like a blast from the past.
Yeah, because, I mean, we were looking for servers to store all of our footage, and we couldn't do it because it costs so much of the time to have a website. But now they're like a dime a dozen. You can have a domain for a few bucks, you know?
I think back in the day, everybody had to have a GeoCities.
Right. You just knew how to, once you knew how to build it yourself, then you can move on to bigger, better things, you know.
All right. Okay, yes. So, Marky, I think we've got a few minutes left, so why don't we spend our last 5 minutes having a little bit of fun? We will play a round of Guess the Creature. Are you in, Jeff?
Yeah, let's go for it.
Yes, the creature.
Absolutely. Don't know if Mel's here. Okay, so what we do is we get a clue. You are here. That's cool. You get a clue. There will be three clues. The first clue is worth 15 points. Now, for each clue, you can either give a guess or pass. If you give a guess, that's it. You are locked in for the rest of the clues. And the last clue is worth not very many points. So in this season of Anomalous Realities, points mean nothing other than what the hell,
bragging
let's just
rights.
Have some fun. You're bragging rights. But maybe next season it will mean something. Anyway, we can go to our first clue.
The first clue is...
I once roamed the Earth over 65 million years ago.
Now, I've got to try and trick you a bit this time. But, Lenita.
Oh, gosh.
Guess or pass.
Once roamed the Earth. I think I know. I'm going to go for the 15-pointer. I'm going to say Nessie.
Very brave. Mel.
I'm very brave, yes.
I'll pass.
You'll pass. Stay safe. And Jeff?
Well, I would just say dinosaurs, because they were around, right? Is that a good...
You can pass, because you don't want to lock into that unless you're sure.
I would go with it.
Okay.
Okay, going with dinosaurs.
We're locked in.
In the Mel play.
The second clue is...
I was a feared carnivore. In those days, I ate many animals.
Nessie, did it eat many animals?
Oh, no!
Mel? For 10 points, Mel? Or you can... really assured points.
I don't know. Pass.
Passing. Okay, so...
The third and final clue is...
Nowadays... I only eat people who are sitting on toilets in parks.
Oh, it is a dinosaur. It's Tyrannosaurus Rex.
So we had Nessie, T-Rex, and just dino.
Oh my gosh.
Correct. This creature was a Tyrannosaurus Rex.
Oh man.
I'm afraid dinosaur is...
I think.
But that was my.
I think it kind of counts.
That was my first dinosaur. Thought. It was Tyrannosaurus Rex because of the fact that when I thought dinosaur, I thought to myself, like, you know, what else could it be? You know.
I think he has to get guest points for that.
Yep. 5 guest points. Okay. Next.
One
next
more.
Creature.
The first clue is.
I do not live on Earth. But I am certainly residing somewhere within our solar system.
So, don't think too hard, Lenita. Guess or pass?
Pass.
Mel?
Pass.
Jeff?
I'm going to pass on that one.
Okay.
Second.
The second clue is...
I may or may not be red in color, but the planet that I'm from... certainly is.
Lenita?
Huh. A creature. We're guessing a creature here, right? Is it a fictional creature?
You only get to guess or pass.
I'll pass.
Passing? Mel.
Martin the Martian.
The only Martian. Jeff?
I would say I'm a pass.
All right, next clue.
The third and final clue is...
Some might say that I'm a bit like Matt Damon.
Matt Damon!
In that recent movie.
So you can still get 5 points, Vanita.
It's a creature, though, right?
Yep.
Okay, I'm going to say Marvin the Martian.
Okay. And Jeff.
It would have to be some type of Martian. But what type?
I know, right?
This creature was
Matt Damon.
A Martian.
Okay, so any Martian works. All right, that is all the time we have for tonight. Jeff, thank you for being with us. I hope you've had some fun, and you'll come back sometime in the future, because I have a feeling we've got more UFO talk to do.
Yeah, it'd be great. Have a great one, guys.
Yeah. Bye. Have a wonderful evening, everyone. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.